and contact tracing, then social distancing measures may be your only option to create distance between individuals. But as we've said in previous press conferences, there are very costly interventions in terms of societal acceptance. They're very costly in economic terms, and they have to be used in a time-limited fashion with the specific purpose of slowing down infection enough to protect the health system. And I think this is the difference. Very often in public health, we use case finding and contact tracing to go after the virus, to stop, to interrupt, to push back. That's the purpose of those public measures. The purpose of social distancing is only to slightly slow down the virus so your health system can cope. The objectives are different. And I think we have to be clear that social distancing measures are not a panacea. Social distancing measures are not going to stop this epidemic. They're not going to stop this pandemic purely in their own right. And if countries want to really turn this around, for those countries that are in a position to do that, and it's been clearly demonstrated in places, in other places, then investing back in a measured, comprehensive strategy, as Dr. Tedros has referred to it so many times, of trying to still do the kind of case-finding, contact tracing, isolation, to push the virus back. That is not to say that certain social distancing measures will not have a positive impact, but they come at a cost and must be considered, as Dr. Tedros has said, in the local context. And there's a local context that is both in public health terms, but also in societal acceptance terms. A society may accept social distancing in one part of the world, and they may reject it in another. And governments have to balance those genuine dilemmas around social and community acceptance.
In addition to what Mike has said, he mentioned this comprehensive package of measures, and the DG has said this repeatedly. So social distancing is one aspect that we have been promoting here, but this is in addition to a lot of other measures that we have also been promoting, which include case and contact finding, aggressive case and contact finding, and testing. Testing needs to be appropriate in each country to ensure that we know who are cases and who are not cases. It also includes hand hygiene, washing your hands with soap and water, using an alcohol-based rub, making sure that you also practice respiratory etiquette. You are sneezing into your elbow or coughing into your elbow, making sure that we mobilize all of our population. It is very important that every single person on the planet knows what the signs and symptoms of COVID-19 are. The signs and symptoms of COVID-19 is not sneezing and having a runny nose. It's a fever. It's a dry cough. It's aches and pains. It's very important that we know those differences. Some people will also have difficulty breathing. And so knowing what the signs and symptoms are, knowing what your risk may be, will help protect you and help protect your family.
Thank you very much. Just to remind journalists to ask one question at the time. So let's try now with Banjo Kaur from down to earth from India. Banjo, can you hear us?
Thank you very much. Just to remind journalists to ask one question at the time. So
can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you now. Please.
Now go ahead.
With Banjo Kaur from
my question is, India has blocked the travel for all foreign nationals coming from across the globe.
Hello?
Does WHO think, can you hear me? It's own assessment.
Yes, we can hear you now. Please go ahead.
My question is, India has blocked the travel for all foreign nationals.
Specifically said that each sovereign country must decide upon its own measures to protect its population. But we've also consistently said is that blanket travel measures in their own right will do nothing to protect an individual state. In fact, many countries who had outright travel bans early in the response ended up importing cases anyway and may have reacted later than they should have because they assumed travel restrictions would protect them. So I think it's very important that the main focus in this fight is not on anything other than the public health measures, case detection, isolation, getting increasing number of tests done. People who know their status can protect others. It's a little bit like in the HIV epidemic. Until people could understand my status, if I know I'm infected, I can protect others. So we need to move to that sort of a stance, and investing in the capacity to do that, investing in the ability to treat cases effectively and give proper reassurance in community education and community mobilization. As part of an overall comprehensive strategy, there is a place, particularly inside national borders, for potentially restricting movement between zones, as we've seen in certain places. But there is rarely justification for blanket bans, unless, of course, the context and the risk defines that. So it's difficult for us to comment on the individual action of an individual nation. We would have to fully understand the risk assessment and the vulnerability assessment that was carried out in India.
Thank you very much. So let's try to get to NHK now. If we have someone, otherwise NPR, sorry, and then we will get to NHK after that. Do we have anyone from NPR?
Yeah, hi, this is Ting. Can you hear me?
Yes, please, go ahead.
Hi, this is Ting Huang from National Public Radio. I wanted to ask about stigma. So Dr. Jameson
NPR,
said that
sorry,
stigma
and
is
then,
more dangerous
we will get to
than
NHK
disease
after that.
Do we have
anyone from NPR?
To reduce stigma
yeah,
in their
hi,
communities, and are there actually any examples of leaders
yes,
that are
please,
doing
go
it
ahead.
Right? Hi.
I think there's something everyone can do to battle against stigma. You know, to educate yourself about what this virus is, where it's circulating. No one is at fault for getting infected with this virus. We need to help each other as best we can. We see many examples of countries helping each other within their own populations, whether this is providing some support to families who have infected cases, providing support to families who have members who are in quarantine, providing support to healthcare workers who are working on the front line, bringing them groceries or helping them clean their homes. And we need to all stand up to stigma. We need to stand up to people who are pointing out that someone may be at fault for being from a certain country. This absolutely should not be tolerated in any form. And we do see many good examples of it, and we need to make sure that we promote that. But everyone has a responsibility here to do the right thing and to help each other out during this difficult time.
Mm-hmm. If I could add, because there's another word that goes with stigma, and that is exclusion. And there are two processes here. One is, as Maria has very well explained, the issue of stigma associated with the disease or profiling according to that. But there's also something we need to avoid. We've been speaking very much about those who are vulnerable in our societies. And that vulnerability is very important to deal with. But when we speak about that vulnerability, we cannot forget migrants. We cannot forget undocumented workers. We cannot forget prisoners in prisons. They may be serving sentence, but they deserve no less protection under the law than others. So when we talk about stigma, we also need to really look carefully at exclusion. We're working very closely with the Office of the High Commissioner for Human Rights, with the Red Cross movement. We were on the telephone this morning. We've been speaking about joint activities around issues like this. The Director General has said many times, we must leave no one behind. Because the only way to beat this is to leave no one behind. So when we talk about stigma, we also need to avoid that, but we need to avoid exclusion as well. We're in this together, and I hope we can finish this together.
Yes, I fully agree, and this is everyone's business, and nobody should be excluded. But the only thing I'd like to add to this is especially political leaders, religious leaders, community leaders have a special role to play here, to bridge and also to tell our followers to adhere to just basic morality, respecting others. And this virus is a common enemy. So I would expect and call upon all political leaders, religious leaders, and community leaders to play a bigger role here.
Thank you very much. Let's try to move to Karachi in Pakistan, Express Tribune. Do we have someone online?
Hello, can you hear us, please?
Yes, yes, please, go ahead. Hello, we can, yes, we can hear you.
Hi, I'm Nilda, yes.
Yes, we can hear you, please go ahead.
Hi, I'm Nilda from the Express Tribune.
Okay, welcome, please.
My question is, what does the epidemiological outlook in Pakistan look like in the near future?
Thank you very much.
It's difficult to predict the epidemiologic outlook in any country. I have personally worked in Pakistan on polio eradication for nearly 3 years, and very much enjoyed my time working with some excellent Pakistani colleagues working on infectious disease control, among them Dr. Rana Safdar. I think there's a great capacity in Pakistan, there's a great public health capacity, but there are also great challenges. You have a highly mobile population, you have great mega cities, and you have many underserved people. So there is a great challenge facing Pakistan. But Pakistan has also demonstrated time and time again with dengue, with polio, with other diseases, how all of government, all of society approaches can be made to work. So we wish Pakistan all the best luck in the world, and all of our assistance in supporting some fine public health servants in your country.
Thank you very much. Hope this answered question on Pakistan. Now we go to Moscow, to Komeksant FM, and we have Uliana calling. Uliana, can you hear us?
Yep. Can you hear me?
Yes, please go ahead.
Well, my questions are, when do you think the COVID-19 will peak in the world? And given that the vaccine has not yet been developed, does WHO have any recommendations about drugs or medications that can be effective in the treatment process?
Thank you very much.
So the first question is, when will this peak in the world? That's a very good question, and I'm sure everyone has that on their mind. One thing we are not able to do is to predict what will happen. What we need to do is prepare for any scenario. And the trajectory of this pandemic, the trajectory of each epidemic in each country, is dependent on the actions of each country. So what we have seen in several countries in Asia, we've seen them tackle this virus, be aggressive in their approach in terms of finding their cases and contacts, and have this comprehensive approach that we've discussed previously, mobilizing their workforce, having an all of government, all of society approach. We've seen them turn the corner. So we've seen them have very strong, very bad epidemics, and have them peak. Hopefully that they've peaked. China has certainly peaked, and there's been a decline, but there's always the chance that those cases can increase again. So we always have to be on the ready to look for any cases that pop up. With regards to the rest of the world, as I said, it will depend on how countries react to their first cases and if they have an aggressive approach to those first cases. For countries that are dealing with clusters of cases, it will depend on how they aggressively look for the chains of transmission within those clusterings of cases, making sure that they identify every single case, every contact, separate the contacts, put them in quarantine. And for those countries that are dealing with much larger outbreaks and community transmission, making sure that there's a much broader approach in terms of mobilizing their entire workforce to support the response to this, making sure that their hospitals have the possibility to cope with increasing numbers of cases. But it's impossible for us to say when this will peak globally. We hope that it is sooner rather than later, but again, we can't emphasize enough that there have been countries that have demonstrated the ability to turn the tide to suppress transmission, and it is in the hands of every country to be able to do that. So we are hoping that more countries put more aggressive efforts into doing so.
On the issue of drugs and vaccines, there's been there are a large number of trials underway of therapeutic options, and we will speak in more detail early next week. We are very excited with the level of solidarity and cooperation going on between member states, between scientific institutions, who are putting together a global platform for being able to carry out these trials together using the same approaches, using the same protocols, and sharing that data, and being able to have a much more powerful opportunity to identify effective therapies. We will speak in much more detail on that next week. Equally, on the vaccine side, we're working extremely closely with CEPI, but also with Gavi and other institutions. There is a major funding gap on that side as well. It's not just for the operational response and supporting countries with weaker health systems. We have to move now to manage the risks and make the investments we need to develop vaccines going into the future. And we're working very closely with our colleagues in CEPI on that. And the fund that's been launched today will cover many aspects of that, including investments in vaccine development through partner institutions like CEPI.
Thank you very much. I will read one question that I received through SMS from DPA, German news agency, our friend Christian Ulrich, who is asking for Dr. Tedros, but maybe also for Mike, what are the biggest lessons the world can learn from Ebola outbreak in Congo in fighting the epidemic?
It's difficult. Sometimes we over-extrapolate from one event to the other, and sometimes we don't learn enough lessons and we don't adapt enough. I think what we've learned in Ebola outbreaks is you need to react quickly. You need to go after the virus. You need to stop the chains of transmission. You need to engage with communities very deeply. Community acceptance is hugely important. You need to be coordinated. You need to be coherent. You need to look at the other sectoral impacts, the schools and security and economic. So it's essentially many of those same lessons. But the lessons I've learned after so many Ebola outbreaks in my career are be fast, have no regrets. You must be the first mover. The virus will always get you if you don't move quickly. And you need to be prepared. And I say this, one of the great things in emergency response, and anyone who's involved in emergency response will know this, if you need to be right before you move, you will never win. Perfection is the enemy of the good when it comes to emergency management. Speed trumps perfection. And the problem in society we have at the moment is everyone is afraid of making a mistake. Everyone is afraid of the consequence of error. But the greatest error is not to move. The greatest error is to be paralyzed by the fear of failure. And I think that's the single biggest lesson I've learned in Ebola responses in the past.
We'll move on. If we may try to get NHK this time around. NHK? NHK, can you hear us? I think it's Shoko who is online. We don't have NHK. Let's move on. Chris, can we get Jeremy, maybe, who was online for some time now? Jeremy from Radio French International. And I would also, while we are waiting to get the journalist online, just to remind you that we have announced the launch of COVID-19 Solidarity Response Fund, and we have colleagues online who can speak about that. So if we should really try to use them and ask questions about the fund itself. But again, it's a press conference and journalists can ask questions they want. Do we have Jeremy online? Jeremy?
Can you hear me?
Yes, Jeremy, please go ahead.
Okay, forgive me because I have my keys right next to me, so you might hear already. I won't try today again to ask you who's doing poorly in Europe, because I know that people want to talk too much about member states. But can I try and ask you who's doing good in Europe regarding containment versus mitigation measures? And then I can try to get by myself who's doing poorly then.
Good. Yeah, I think you just answered my previous question. We are not seeking to identify those who do poorly or do well. We're trying to identify the best lessons we can all use, the best way to move forward together. No one has done perfectly, and no one has made all the mistakes. We share all of the errors together, so we will share failure in the same way we will share success. So if one person makes an error in a team, do you blame the person or the team? Are we a team at global level? We are. Are we a team at national level? We should be. Are we a team at community level? We should be. So we won't break from that. If we have tough discussions, we will have them directly with our member states and with those governments.
If I can add something, I'm not going to answer that direct question, but I want to say something that if there are countries that are starting to identify cases and starting to identify large numbers of cases because they're looking, because they're doing aggressive case and contact finding, they shouldn't be punished from that. It's really important that we support countries in doing the right measures, and sometimes that's going to mean that case numbers are going to increase. And in many countries, it's going to get worse before it gets better. And so I just urge everyone to take caution with that, and that these numbers are going to increase. So please look for cases, you know, please do testing and find those cases, and so we can turn the tide.
Yeah. And if you want to evaluate any institution or governmental approach, ask the questions the Director General asked. Is every member of society know what to do? Does every member of society informed? Is every health worker protected? Is every health worker know this disease and knows what to do? If you can answer those questions as a government, as an institution, as a community, then you're on the right track. If you answer no to any of those questions, you're not ready, or you're not doing enough yet to be ready. So I would point you back to the text of Tedros' speech.
The text will be shared with the audio file in a couple of minutes after we finish the briefing, and we will finish soon. We have a time for two more questions. We will start with Joanne from Meetings Today. We didn't have anyone from Meetings Today before, so Joanne, welcome. Can you hear us?
Yes, thank you. I appreciate it. Thank you for letting me ask this question. I'm in the meetings and hospitality industry. We have obviously been hit very hard. I took the chance and traveled to speak at a conference in the Pacific Northwest in the U.S. My question is, we know that sports stars and other stars and government officials are reporting when they've had contact with others. In asking hotels and airlines in the United States what their process is in order to have anyone who finds out that they have been diagnosed with COVID-19 report back to the airline, the hotel, the organization. To the best of my knowledge, nothing is in place. What should be done? And Dr. Maria, this goes back a bit to your response about ID and contacts.
I'll take the first part, and Maria will follow up on the direct technical side. If the strategy is about case finding and contact tracing and truly focused on containment, then any institution that was in the pathway of that person should be informed, because there are potentially other contacts in that circumstance. So no question in that regard. In a mitigation strategy, nobody is, very often, people stop looking for those direct contacts and direct individual risks. So therefore, it's very difficult to go back to each institution when you have a new case in a hospital. There's no public health authority mandated, funded, or tasked with going back, finding out where that person might have been. So it really depends on what the strategy of each individual government is. On a more general level, we work very closely with the World Tourism Organization, with the Civil Aviation Organization, with the International Air Transport Association, and so many others, in trying to come up with common guidelines and common technical inputs for all of our partners in the hospitality and travel industry. And we do feel for your industry in particular, in terms of the impacts it's had on you. We thank you for your participation, your cooperation, and for the sacrifices you're making to help cope with this pandemic. We certainly will work harder, and especially in those contexts where it is possible, to ask governments to share more risk information with your institutions.
Only to add to that there does need to be a process in place to identify contacts of confirmed cases. And in many situations, in many cities, in many governments, there is a process in place. If you haven't been contacted as a known contact of a confirmed case, contact your local Department of Health. Contact your local ministry or your GP and say, I believe I'm a contact, what should I do?
Durée indéterminée. Nous pensons à toutes les familles d'un bout à l'autre du pays qui ont reçu le même diagnostic. Mais nous sommes entre bonnes mains. Nous avons pleinement confiance dans les professionnels de la santé et les autorités de la santé publique du Canada. Ça veut dire que, suite à la recommandation de mon médecin, je suis en isolement pour 14 jours. Je veux être clair, je n'ai aucun symptôme. Je me sens très bien. Je travaille de la maison par précaution. De nos jours, la technologie nous permet de travailler à distance. C'est sûr que ce n'est pas idéal et c'est un peu frustrant. Nous sommes, d'après tout, tous des êtres sociaux. Mais c'est ce qu'on doit faire pour protéger nos voisins, nos amis, surtout les personnes âgées, les plus vulnérables et ceux qui souffrent de conditions de santé. Nous suivons l'avis des médecins comme tous les Canadiens devraient faire en ce moment. Je veux en profiter pour remercier tous les professionnels de la santé et l'Agence de santé publique qui font un travail exemplaire pour nous appuyer. Je veux maintenant vous faire part des démarches que le Canada entreprend pour assurer votre sécurité et protéger votre santé.